So probability can be said as one of the basic, you know, foundation blocks of the subject statistic. Now, all the techniques what we have discussed till now, whether it is the concept of mean or the concept of standard deviation, there is a hidden probability technique under that. So much of the, you know, tools and discuss what we have discussed, they are the result of the probability. Now, probability simply talks about quantifying the chance. So numerical measure of chance of happening. Numerical measure of chance of happening. So you are looking into various possible activities or events happening around the world. Now you want to predict or you want to come across what is the chance of happening a particular event. Say, what is the chance that it will rain today? What is the chance that the temperature will go up to, you know, by 5 degrees? What is the probability that a flight which has taken, plane which has taken the flight will land safely? What are the chances of observing a patient with very high blood pressure? What are the chances that tomorrow my clinic will, no patient will visit my clinic tomorrow? So such, you know, various such events in the real life could be observed. And if I could, you know, somehow predict what are the chances of happening a particular case of that event. Say if you're talking about rainfall, what is the chance that there will be high rainfall? What is the chance that there will be low rainfall? So if you know the answer in prior, so that you can take enough, you know, suitable measures or precautions in order to, you know, meet the demand or the requirement. So in such cases, we need, you know, the concept of probability, or the concept of probability becomes handy in those cases where you want to do some prediction analysis. So those prediction could be, you know, by using the techniques of mean, standard deviation, etc. As said, they are always based on the probability. Now, to compute the numerical chance of probability, we should understand what an event is. So we should try to quantify the event numerically. And then we will see what are the various possible values taken by this particular event. And based on that, we could, you know, come up with a numerical measure which measures the chance of happening of that event. And that number is called as probability. So basically, we are seeing what is the, you know, percentage of this particular case in the event. What is the percentage of this happening? And we roughly call that percentage of proportion as probability in a long run scenario. Now, there are two ways of finding this probability. Now, to understand the concept of probability, first we should have the concept of what called as a random experiment. Now, the chance and the cases, these comes into picture whenever you are talking about uncertainty in the surroundings or related to certain activities. Now, if you are very much certain that this is going to happen, then there are, you know, 100%, you know, 100% chance of exactly happening that. In that case, we need not worry about the probability. Say, for example, a pregnant woman was, you know, very much sure. So she has undergone certain various medical checkups and she knows the gender of the baby. So she definitely with guarantee can say that she will give birth to, you know, a male baby or a female baby. So in that case, we are not interested in, you know, measuring the chance. But on the other hand, if you just, you know, the parents have just come to know that they are, you know, pregnant and they are expecting a child, then they are not sure whether they are going to give birth to a male baby or a female baby. In that case, I say the presence of uncertainty is there. So till they take up some tests and get to know the gender of the baby, the uncertainty will prevail. Now, similarly, if you are talking about a manufacturing process or if you are doing some experiments in your laboratory, there are chances of, you know, achieving various types of results. You could be successful in, you know, completing the experiment, or you could fail the experiment, or you could, the experiment could be such that you know, at certain times the result will be the same, or at certain times the results are different. So based on the type of the result what we observe, we categorize the experiments into two cases, random experiment and deterministic experiment. Now, when I say random experiment, the experiments are such that whenever you repeat the experiment under the same condition, same environment, the outcomes will be different. So though the same person, under same conditions, identical conditions, same environment, the experiment is repeated, but every time when I repeat an experiment, the result is different, outcome is different. So that is, you are not unable to predict what exactly the outcome is. Say, for example, talk about the experiment of producing the item. So you are manufacturing some mobiles, or let me take it as a simple bolt. So there is a production unit which produces the bolt. Now the bolt should be produced such that it should, you know, you give importance to the diameter of the bolt as well as the length of that particular bolt. Now the diameter should be such that, or the radius of the bolt should be such that it should, you know, get fixed to that particular nut which will be used in affixing or anchoring certain type of items. On the other hand, if you violate this rule, or, you know, if there is a slight change in the diameter or the slight change in the length of the bolt, the produced item is treated as defective, and that, you know, may not be used. It is not suitable to market that particular item. So there is uncertainty assigned there. So though you properly tune the machine based on the type of the raw materials used and based on the experience of the person, maybe the power fluctuations. So because of some reasons which could be identified, some reasons which cannot be identified, there is certainty, and the produced bolt could be categorized into two cases, which is a defective bolt and non-defective bolt. There, our objective now will be identifying what is the probability of manufacturing that defective bolt. And if I could come or minimize that probability, then the chance of only manufacturing non-defective bolts, or the production unit could be set such that in most of the times, the non-defective bolts could be manufactured. So to do that, I need the concept or the knowledge of probability. So probability comes into picture whenever you mainly talk about uncertainty. On the other hand, there are certain examples where whenever you repeat the experiment, you are very much sure to get a particular outcome every time. Just to verify the result, we are performing the experiment, but the outcomes are certain. Now, those experiments where the outcomes are certain are called as deterministic, because you know the outcome in advance. So, I'll get exactly this result. So, I know the result in advance, but just to verify, just to learn the procedure of doing the experiment, I am conducting those experiments. So, almost all the experiments what you do in your chemistry and your physics laboratory, so there the outcomes are certain. Just to verify the result, or just to obtain the data from the experiment, you are conducting the experiment. So even you hear about this, that every time experiment success aago illa bere bere outcomes baruthe anta, but you know they come under deterministic, because the outcomes are different because you are making some mistakes at the time of performing the experiment. So when I say add a certain ratio of x to y, whenever you do that, it is theoretically proved that when you add certain percent of X chemical with certain percent of Y, it actually produces chemical Z. So that is, you know, verified universally, theoretically. So whenever you do this experiment, you will always expect it to achieve the result as Z. But if you mess up in the procedure of conducting the experiment, or your environmental situations, the environment or your laboratory conditions are not supportive, in that case you could get a different answer. But you know, they come under the category of deterministic, because whenever you perform the experiment under the identical conditions, they are always bound to give you the same result. But when you talk about the experiments, so which I said, you want to observe the gender of the baby, or you want to, you know, classify whether the manufactured items are defective and non-defective, and you are tossing a coin. Now, this is a classical example when it comes to understanding the probability. Now, all these mathematical and real life situations where the uncertainty is associated, we categorize those experiments and as random experiment. And one such mathematical experiment, which is random, is tossing of a coin. Now, whenever I toss a coin, the possible outcomes are either getting an head or tail. So we indicate head by the symbol H and tail by T, and we enclose these possible outcomes by the flower bracket, and we indicate or denote that by the symbol S, which is called as sample space of the experiment. So you're talking about random experiments. So these random experiments are also called as statistical experiments or probabilistic experiments. So as I said, whenever there is uncertainty, the concept of probability comes into picture. So if we talk about what is the probability of happening of this particular case, what is the chance that I'll observe tail when I toss a coin? So you can assign the numerical probabilities, and hence those experiments are also called as probabilistic experiments. Now, whenever you are talking about a random experiment, there are different possible outcomes for that experiment. Now, if you could list all those different possible outcomes in a form of a set and indicate that set by S, then that is called as sample space. So sample space is basically a set of all possible outcomes of the random experiment. All possible outcomes of random or statistical experiment, and any conduction of this particular experiment. So you are doing an experiment or repeating an experiment, then that is called as a trial of experiment. So just to see what could be the result if you perform the experiment, that is said to be a trial of the experiment. Now, repetitive trials are taken to observe what are the various possible values or the results for that particular experiment, and then you could come up with a list of different possible outcomes. Now, one such sample space is tossing off a coin, which produces S is equal to H, T. And whenever we toss a coin, we are bound to get either a head or a tail. Therefore, this is the sample space. Now, similarly, when you look into the experiment of counting the number of tosses required to reach the first head. Number of tosses to achieve first head. A coin toss maadidre yavaglu first head banduthe anta helik agode. So in that case, if you look into the sample space, so you are counting how many times you have to toss the coin. So if you are lucky enough, you can get the head in the first toss. So number of tosses required to achieve the first head. So even in the very first toss, I could get head. If the first toss results in tail, then you will take the second toss and you may achieve the head in the second trial or second toss. So 2 is also a possible number for the number of tosses. Now, if you're repeatedly getting tails only, then the number of tosses required to achieve the first head will take the values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So you will conduct the experiment and see what the particular outcome is. So why I gave this example is to differentiate the possible sample space here. So you could have an experiment which is as simple like this, which is producing a finite sample space. You could have an experiment which produces infinite sample space. Now, the problem of assigning the probabilities becomes very easy when you deal with the finite sample space. When you look into the infinite sample space, we talk about a different method of assigning the probabilities, and that is by actually repeating the experiment for a large number of cases. And the first case we call the assignment of probabilities by what called as a mathematical way or more classical way, and that is said to be the classical definition of probability or simply classical probability. So what is this classical probability? It tells that you have to know the finite sample space. So whenever I say finite, we use the notation that my sample space has n number of items. So this n of s indicates number of elements or different possible outcomes in your sample space, and it is simply indicated by n. Now, once you define the sample space, now you create the event from the sample space. So events are basically the subset of s. So as said, you have various possible elements of S, but you are interested in a particular case, then specify what is that particular case and identify the favorable outcomes with respect to your case. And if you write that as a set, then that is indicated by event, and events are indicated by symbols or notations like A, B, C, or you could have E1, E2, A1, A2, etc. notations. So S is, you know, restricted to sample space. Any other notation other than S, any other alphabet is used to identify the event. So let me give an example here. So we are talking about throw of a dice. Whenever we throw a dice, the possible outcome, throw of a dice is the experiment here. Now, this experiment could lead you to 6 different possible answers. So you could expect 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. So only these are the 6 possible. So I'm talking about dice, and then usually we talk about the 6 face dice, the cube. So it has 6 numbers printed on each face. So we say the outcome as the number what we observe in the topmost part when a die is rolled. So we have n is equal to 6. Now, whenever you are in a competitive situation where you are throwing the die and you are in a situation where you will win, whether you get the number as 1 or you win when you get the number as 6 or a multiple of 2 or a number more than 4 or a number less than 3. So you have a particular requirement. So what is your requirement? That requirement is nothing but the set of favorable outputs. So let me say I'm, you know, playing a game of, say, dice, and I am in a position now where if I get the result as either 1 and 6, I will win that particular game. So my requirement is observing 1 or 6 out of these 6 possibilities. So 1 and 6 are said to be favorable outcomes for me. And the number of elements in the set defined event is indicated by n of p, and in general scenario, it is indicated by m, and in this example, it is 2. And you can define your event as using simple English phrases, like say getting number 1 or 6. Now, similarly, you could list, you know, infinitely many such possible events. So certain situations, I'm interested in getting odd number. At cases, may I need only 6. You could have your expectation as getting an even number, getting multiple of 3, or getting a number which is less than 4, more than 5, more than or equal to 5. So many such possible events could be defined on a single sample space. Now, so this is the basic work which you need, or the information which you need prior to obtain the probability. So here, we are not at all, you know, actually performing any experiments. We just know the knowledge. So past experiments have revealed that this is the possible sample space. So if you have just the knowledge of sample space, you could list out the events which are required for you. and you could come up with the numbers M and N, where M indicates how many elements are there in your event, N indicates how many elements are there in the sample space, then probability is defined as the ratio of N by N. And we say, we indicate this probability by symbol P and E enclosed within the brackets, and it is called as P of E, where E is the event, and that is given by M by N, or in a more general scenario, it is the ratio of these two counts. How many values you have in your event divided by total possible outcomes in the sample space. So as said, this method works only if you have finite number. If you have infinite number, you will have N as infinity, and mathematically any number divided by infinity goes to zero. So zero doesn't imply that you will not get that particular result. So as said in the previous example, when you're counting the number of tosses to achieve the first head, if I'm talking about a case where I have, you know, N is equal to infinity here, so literally or practically it doesn't mean that you have to take infinite tosses to observe the head. That is not the case. So if you go on, you know, repeating the experiment, you may achieve the first head in the second toss. Other person may achieve in the fourth toss. Some could achieve in the first toss. But when you, you know, collectively do this experiment for a large number of cases, say if you repeat it for 100 times, in most of the cases, you observe the heads in the very few cases of the initial values of yes. So very hardly you will be taking 10 tosses or 8 tosses, but within say 2 to 5 tosses, you may observe head. But when you look into all possibilities, you can have a case where you are observing it in the 100 toss or 200 toss. So that's why generally we say N is equal to infinity. But when you look into the particular cases, it is not so. So though I have the situation, I cannot be applying that definition. There we use the concept of what called as statistical methods of applying the probability, and that is by using the frequencies and the concept of relative frequency. So this is about your mathematical way. So Hilly, we are not doing any experiment, in the sense we have already performed the experiments. We have enough knowledge on sample space as well as the events. So if I say what is the chance that I'll get 1/6 or 1 or 6 in this example, so that will be equal to 2/6, which is roughly say 0.33. And 0.33 is nothing but 33%. Now, this is telling you that when you roll a die, and if you are in a situation where you want either 1 or 6, there is 33% chance that you will win that situation. But that doesn't mean that if I take 100 tosses or 100 trials, out of which 33 cases will be 1 and 6. That never happens, because if you are interested in a very basic event where your event has a single number, that is, you are in a situation where if you get 1, you will win the particular game. So in that case, your probability now becomes 1/6, because your M is equal to only 1 here. So we are not looking into the numerical value, we are counting how many observations. So that's why we use the notation N of E. So probability is say 0.166 here. So what it tells mathematically is that if you roll the die 6 times, one time necessarily you will observe the number 1. But that is not the real life situation. So neurologically, game of dice aata aadidira. So whenever you are now playing the snake and ladder and you are in that last number 99, you need to roll a 1 in order to win, but you are taking 5, 10, 12 throws, but you have not got the number 1. But mathematical concept is telling if you roll the die 6 times, there will be necessarily 1 time 1. So that doesn't happen practically. So that's why in most of the situations, we are not using the method of assigning probabilities using the classical approach, because that requires the knowledge on the sample space. They put a condition that the sample space should be finite, and we put another condition that every outcome is equally likely. So this is one of the basic assumption in the classical approach. Equally likely. What is equally likely? Equally likely indicates that equal chance of observing every outcome. This is the simple meaning of equally likely. But this often doesn't happen in the real life situation. So if you are, say, want to talk about the event of observing rain. So you have event of observing rain. You categorize, say, the sample space of as, say, no rain, high rain, moderate rain. So all possible cases. So let me say you are talking about 5 such cases. Then you cannot say there is equal chance of no rain, equal chance of moderate rain, equal chance of high rain. So it is actually based on the season, the climatic conditions, the weather conditions, the environmental conditions, etc. So this assumption is not true here. And this happens in almost all the cases, whether you're tossing a coin, they are tossing several coins, throw of a dice. So whenever you know you violate this particular rule, you cannot simply define probability as m by n. We use another technique, which is called as the statistical approach. So here it tells you do the experiment, conduct the experiment, and observe the results repeatedly for several large number of trials. That will give you the frequencies. Now use those frequencies and obtain or convert those frequencies into proportions and use those proportions as the probability. So this, you know, is the most wide technique of, you know, obtaining the probabilities, because whenever we talk about the real life situation, we usually, you know, solely dependent on what has observed, what we have observed in the past, what is happening now, and using that will predict what is happening in the future. So we are solely dependent on the data. So when I say data, data is nothing but the result of experiment. So whatever may be the data, you can assign a prior random experiment to that, and you could say that data is a result of that particular experiment. Now, coming to that same question of answering, what is the chance of getting either 1 or 6? So if you are using the mathematical approach, now this says repeat the experiment. That is, repeatedly throw the dice for a large number of times. For a large number of times. So let me say I'll throw it 20 times, or I'll throw it 100 times, or I'll throw it 500 times, 1000 times. And there are certain number of people, you know, who are very crazy statisticians there, who have actually conducted such experiments and come up with the various frequencies. So let me give you a situation where my n is equal to 20. So I'm throwing the dice 20 times. And every time I'm recording what is the outcome. But I know the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in each case, X is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But the frequency will be different. So I might have not observed 1 at all in those 20 trials. 2 might have come for 5 cases. Maybe 3 times, 4 times, 2 times. And then 6 times 5, so which makes a total of 20. So this is the frequency distribution, which I call observed frequency distribution, when I have conducted the experiment 20 times. Now, if you conduct the same experiment, you are definitely bound to get different values for this. But when you compute the convert the frequencies into proportions, and one such proportion what we have already studied is relative frequency, and at the time of defining relative frequency I said this is also proportion, and later when we talk about the concept of probability we use this as the probabilities. So this becomes 0 by 20, 5 by 20, 3 by 20, 4 4 by 20, 6 by 20, 2 by 20. So now if I want to answer the question, what is the chance of getting 1 or 6? That is a total of 2 cases out of 20, or it will be 0 plus 20 by 2 by 20, which comes to say 0.1, or only say 10% chance. So if your dice is such that it produces only 1 or 6, 10% of the times, then your probability of winning is very low. Now, I have got these as my frequencies. Now, the question, when you repeat or you conduct the experiment for this case, the scenario, the frequencies will be different and the ratios will be different. So, every time you conduct the experiment, your probability changes. So, that's why we insist, don't compute the probabilities whenever you're talking about a very small case of n. You have to take a large case like this. And if you repeatedly, you know, observe this for a large cases, whatever the frequencies you observe and whatever the relative frequencies you observe in each of these cases, the R value will be very much closer to each other. Now you can take this. So if you are free, you observe, throw a die 100 times. Again, you repeat it, you will observe almost the frequencies are almost same. Or if you are, you know, very much good in your software like Java or your R or Excel, you can actually simulate the experiment, you know, using the software, and you can observe the frequencies are one and the same. So what we have observed is that when we repeatedly conduct the experiment for a large number of times, in most of the cases, the frequencies will be almost same. So whether you conduct the experiment 10,000 times or 1 lakh times, your R relative frequency come to be the same value. And hence, we can take that relative frequency as the definition of probability. It basically gives you the proportion or percentage of times something is happening, percentage of time something is happening. So till now, the percentage of happening of this number is this. Therefore, we say even in future, the percentage of happening this remains to be same. So that is the logic we are using. And you could argue, how come, so till now we have observed even in future, that is going to same on the hill till the other. And whenever I say future, I mean the near future or the immediate future. Say if you're talking about the volatility of your price of stocks or price of goods, price of gold, in a day-to-day basis, there is no much change. But the change happens in a long run, either over a period of 1 week or 1 month or 1 year. And this 1 week or 1 month has already produced you enough data, which is, you know, suggesting the changes, or the changes are reflected. So again, those new data is also incorporated. Those new frequencies are incorporated in order to obtain the next future value. So the logic prevails there, and such methods are used in, you know, dealing with the stock values and dealing with the price of gold, estimation of sales or price of silver and other such components. Now coming to the statistical definition, so here we say probability of any event is defined as limit n tends to infinity m divided by n, where n is total times an experiment is conducted, total times an experiment is actually conducted or observed, and m is the total times a favorable result is observed. Favorable result or outcome is observed. So, in a pair of limits, and I use mathematical limits, no. So, here we literally mean it says do repeat experiment for a large case. For a large case. So, large is mathematically said as infinity. So that's why we just say n tends to infinity. Now there is a difference here. So if you look into the classical approach, there the meaning of, though we are using the same notations m and n, their meaning is different. Ali m andre ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಎಷ್ಟು ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಎನ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಎಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎಷ್ಟು ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಯಾಂಪಲ್ ಸ್ಪೇಸ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಈವೆಂಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವಿ ಒಬ್ಟೇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರಾಬಬಿಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಬೈ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ದ ಫ್ರೀಕ್ವೆನ್ಸಿ ಸೊ ವಿ ಕಂಡಕ್ಟ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಅ ಲಾರ್ಜ್ ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಟೈಮ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಒಬ್ಟೇನ್ ದ ಕೌಂಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಸೆವರಲ್ ಪಾಸಿಬಲ್ ಔಟ್ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವಿ ಒಬ್ಟೇನ್ ದ ರೇಷಿಯೋ of that frequency to total frequency. So it is basically your f by n only, where your n is the total number of times an experiment is conducted. And that value becomes probability only if your n is large. So if you are dealing with very small values of n, like say 30, 20, 50, or 100, you cannot take that relative frequency to be probability. For it to consider a probability, your n should be very large. And in most of the situations where we are talking about, you know, collection of data such through such experiments, we already have the past data with us, like the sales of gold or the price of gold. Price of gold is being recorded by, you know, various persons, various, you know, shops over decades as well as centuries. So that data is already there. Now, similarly, if you talk about the data related to the gender of the baby. So several hospitals are compulsorily recording what is happening to the gender of the newborn baby. So only, you know, based on that only we have come across the values like say sex ratios and all. So past data is there, it is hidden. Only thing is you should have the suitable knowledge and you should know how to extract that hidden data. So once you have the data, you have the values of M and N. So certain stuff, probabilities could be come. So I'll stop the session here. So if you want to have much deeper knowledge, you can go to chapter 10 and 6, 7, 8, 9. Chapter 9 of that first PC book. So there, you know, probabilities, the basic concepts, events, different types of events, adala heldara. But namge in detail bekagilla, you should have the sufficient knowledge on how to obtain the probabilities and what are the two methods of obtaining the probabilities. That is sufficient. So I'll wind up the session here. So in the next class, in the next week, we'll see, we'll take some numerical problems on estimating the probabilities and then